Thank you, Jesus. All right, well, if you have your Bibles, and if you don't have a Bible, I just want to always remind you that we keep some King James Bibles on that back table back there because we use the King James Version of the Bible. And listen, I have reasons. I have real reasons on why I use the King James Bible. And it has to do with the manuscripts. And the best thing that I think I could do for you, instead of me trying to take more time and go off on a rabbit trail, I do this a lot of times, is if you like to watch videos and things like that, there's a 6-hour, you gotta be dedicated to want to know it, 6-hour, 2-part series called A Lamp in the Dark that explains the history of the Word of God, explains the manuscripts that went behind the King James version of the Bible, and also versus the manuscripts that went behind the newer translations in the World Bible Association and United Bible Society or whatever the case. And it calls into question all of those things, and it gives a history of all of that. And so that would explain to you why I use the King James. It's not just because everybody else told me to use the King James. I'm not following behind a tradition of men. That's something that we're going to talk about this morning, so that's why I keep bringing it up. All right, Colossians chapter 2 is where I want us to plan to read from this morning. And also, we will at some point move to Genesis chapter 4. Colossians chapter 2, and I think we'll probably start in verse 5, but I'm not going to just read just quite yet. But as you can see on this slide that I have on the screen, it's a passage of scripture that comes out of Jude verse 11. If any of you are familiar with the New Testament, if you've read the New Testament, you're aware that Jude is one chapter long. And in verse 11, the scripture says that they, woe unto them, for they have gone in the way of Cain and ran greedily after the error of Balaam for reward and perished in the gainsaying of Korah. As I began to look at this passage of scripture, I almost felt like the Lord was leading me to another series that I might preach on Balaam next week and I might preach on Korah the following week. But I knew ahead of time that the Lord was going to have me mention some things having to do with Cain, because we've actually been doing a mini-series, if you will, about the garden incident. And we'll review it real briefly, maybe in the middle of the message, but the first thought is this, is that we first taught on temptation, then we taught on sin. And my big plan this morning was really to bring out the plan. Not that we didn't bring out the plan in all of those other teachings that we did, because we always stay real close and focused on Jesus Christ and Him crucified, because Amen. We know that that is the plan of God. That is the answer that God has for fallen man. Amen. But this morning's message was really going to focus mostly on the plan. And at the same time, many times I have an idea of where I think that I'm going, but as I begin to sit down and I begin to put pen to paper and begin to let the Holy Spirit deal with me, it kind of starts to take on a form all its own, and I just try to let the Holy Spirit lead me and guide me in the way that He would have me to go. Amen. And so what we see though here, and the emphasis of what I'm trying to say to you, and I hope to communicate to you, is this, is that there's a way. The scripture says they've gone in the way of Cain. And what Jude was talking about was that there were false apostles. False apostles that were spreading false doctrine, and that it was even in the early church at that point in time. Now, I have to be honest with you and tell you that many people have already come against me in my little short period of time of preaching, which is probably about 15 years. Many people have come against me and they said, man, all you ever want to talk about is false doctrine. All you ever want to do is come against false teachers and false doctrine. Well, that's not exactly true, but I will tell you that I do spend a lot of time doing that, but I'm not in bad company. Yeah, I got to be honest with you. Jesus himself warned and said, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees, and Paul repeatedly warned in the scripture, book after book, letter after letter, about false doctrine and about the problems that it can cause in the lives of believers. Amen? And so this is no different, and I want you to know that I'm equating the way of Cain to that very thing. And specifically, I want you to know that I'm equating the way of Cain to the traditions of men. And we'll get to that as we move forward. But one of the first things I wanted to do was the Lord had led me to Colossians chapter 2. Sometimes I just wonder, are you just coming up with this stuff? But you know what? Praise the Lord. I was riding over here this morning and somebody sent me a text message. And in that text message, it had Colossians chapter 2, verse 15 in it. And I said, you know what? That's just the Lord to give me a confirmation that this scripture that I had no plan on using until that, you know, the Lord dropped it in my spirit was somewhere that the Lord wanted us to go. Amen? All right, so here we go. Colossians chapter 2, verse 5. And we're just going to kind of read through, and at the same time, we're going to talk about it as we read. It says in Colossians chapter 2, starting in verse 5, this is the Apostle Paul writing a letter to the church in Colossae. Colossae, look, let me just take a little bit of time here. Please don't get upset with me. This is the western border of Israel again. This is the Sea of Galilee, the Jordan River, the Dead Sea. This area in between here, this strip of land is known as Israel. All of this up here would be something known as Asia Minor. Okay? And within Asia Minor, there were the seven churches of the book of Revelation. Also within here was a church called the area of Colossae. I'm probably going to spell it wrong, and I don't do that on purpose. And so Paul is writing this letter to the church of Colossae, which is on this isthmus of land known as Asia Minor, which is a piece of property or land, if you will, that connects the West, which Greece is over here and Italy is over here. It connects the West to the East. The East being the place of Israel. The East being the land between the two rivers, which is Mesopotamia, Iraq, and the Tigris and the Euphrates River, which would be modern-day Iraq and Iran down here. The East connected to the West, Rome. All of this is the biblical place where the Bible was written. It's important that you understand some concepts of geography if you're really going to begin to understand the Word of God. And that's why I take the time to teach it. And we're going to mix Sunday school along with a preaching message. And we're going to continue to teach the Bible. And I hope that at some point in time, as we continue to repetitively talk about chronology and geography and all of those things together, that it's going to begin to cause you to have a greater understanding of the Word of God, so that one day, now listen to me, I know some of you been reading the Bible for a long time, so I'm not trying to belittle anything that anybody's been doing, but I got to tell you that just last year, and listen, man, this is after a master's degree in theology, that doesn't mean anything, but I'm just telling you, and last year, I called up Robert and I said, dude, I read the Bible today and I knew what I was reading. Oh, hallelujah. I mean, I could just start reading the scripture and understand, but listen to me. I had to understand background information, historical information. I use this a lot. Whenever Jesus was talking to the Pharisees, and he said, before Abraham was, I am. And he told, but he also told them about being in bondage. They said, we've never been in bondage to any man. We'd be Abraham's descendants. You a liar right now, Mr. Pharisee. See, but if I wouldn't have known the history of Israel and what's going on in the background, I would have never known to know that Pharisee was lying. He is lying through his teeth. How do I know that? Because you're in bondage right now, sir. You're a vassal state to Rome. What does that mean? You've already been under bondage to Assyria, to Babylon, to Greece, and now you're in bondage to Rome. Caesar is your emperor, and God is not ruling and reigning in your life. You are not able to live for God the way that you want to, but you've been so blinded by your religion. Come on, sounds like a lot of Christianity, amen? You've been so blinded by your religion and your ways that have been contrary to the things of God that you don't even realize, no, you're in bondage right now, sir. And if you don't understand background information, and you don't, then you don't have a proper understanding of the scriptures. And the fact of the matter is that you just start opening up the Bible somewhere and say, oh, this is what the Lord's saying to me today. Well, hold on a second. You can't take scripture out of context and twist it to make it mean what it is that you think that it means. It has a legitimate meaning, and within that meaning, there's a living principle that will never die. The Word of God is quick, meaning alive, powerful, sharper than a two-edged sword. It divides asunder between bone and marrow and soul and spirit. It's a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. If you let the Word of God do what God intended for it to do, it will reach into your heart, amen, and it will reveal to you things that are in you, amen, and it will draw out of you the things that God desires to draw out of you, and to put in you the things that God desires to put in you. That was just a little side note. We're talking about the letter to Colossae, and this is what the Apostle Paul. Now, let me just tell you this too. There was also the reasoning behind the writing to the church of Colossae had to do with Gnosticism. Gnosticism was a heresy that was entering into the early church. Paul fought against it. John fought against it in his letters. Gnosticism is really the way of the serpent. See, Gnosticism is talking about knowledge. In the day that you eat thereof, you will know. But it's a knowledge of another form. It's not a knowledge coming from God. As a matter of fact, tonight we're starting our series on occult exposure. I can tell you right now that some of you would probably maybe call into question some of the things that I'm going to be talking about. But you know what? It'll be interesting for you, if you can make it at 6 o'clock, to sit through this next 6 weeks and to see the things that I've felt like the Lord allowed me to uncover as I began to study the history of the occult and found out that the enemy of our soul has a much more organized plan than what we ever gave him credit for. Nevertheless, Gnosticism is a form of mysticism which allows the believer to think that it's his understanding intellectually of things that allows him to be illuminated and allows him to contact his deity, if you will. And all they got to do is retool it. You got to understand, all they got to do is put a name on it. They just put a little name, Jesus, on their Gnostic heresy. And all of a sudden, the gullible and the naive say, oh, they love Jesus. It's just like you can watch a video of Alice Cooper who's saying, I grew up in church and I've given my heart back to the Lord. He's still playing the same old stuff. Oh yeah, they got Christians all over the place. Oh, Alice Cooper got saved. And he's doing videos with Kesha. You don't even want to know. You don't want to see it. Okay, trust me, because it's complete Satanism. And at the same time, we just go around, oh, look, this one gave their heart to Jesus. That one gave their heart to Jesus. And there's no fruit. I'm trying to tell you that your enemy is a liar.
Amen.
And he will speak. The only language he speaks is lies. And he will look you in the eyeballs and he will tell you a lie and it'll sound just like it's truth.
That's right.
He wants to deceive us and destroy us. And so anyway, that was what they were combating. That's what the Apostle Paul was combating, is the Gnostic heresy that was trying to infiltrate the church in its early and formative stages. And so this is what the Apostle Paul says in verse 5. For though I be absent in the flesh, in other words, I'm not with you physically, yet I am with you in the spirit, joying and beholding your order and the steadfastness of your faith in Christ. Hallelujah. You know, the covenant that God has provided for mankind is contingent upon faith. That's your part, faith. Faith in what? Faith in God's plan. Well, what is God's plan? Well, we've gone over that quite often, but I'll be honest with you. God has not changed his mind on what his plan is. He's been working salvation history for thousands of years. On the front end, he was working to get Messiah to humanity through the calling of Abraham and the formulation of a nation called Israel. And through that nation called Israel, he gave us Messiah, the Christ, the anointed one, Jesus, who died on the cross. And now God is bringing humanity to that. And anything that tries to stand in the way or deters or removes from the pathway of bringing the sinner and the believer, keeping him there, steadfastness through faith in Christ, is another doctrine and is a lie from the enemy and is keeping our eyes off of God's plan. And if we got our eyes off of God's plan, then we're moving in a direction where there will be no grace to be strengthened by the presence of God. So he says right here in verse 6, as you have therefore received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk ye in him. How did you receive him?
Faith.
How do you walk in him?
Faith
in what?
Faith
in the finished work of Christ. Amen. What does that mean? If it means that Jesus went to the cross and in his sinless, the unleavened bread, hallelujah, what the feast of Leviticus would have called it, the unleavened bread, the righteous one, the holy one, that became incarnate in flesh. And when he was laid upon that cross, the Passover lamb, the fulfillment of the Passover lamb, when he was laid upon that cross, he bore your iniquity, Isaiah 53. He bore your iniquity. He bore your sin. He bore my sin upon himself. Hallelujah. He died in your stead. He took the guilt and the condemnation that we had received in our first birth of Adam, and he paid the penalty to its full. And he said with his last breath, it is finished. And the word in the Greek is hallelujah, tetelestai, paid in full. There's no more payment to be made. You don't have to bring another lamb to the temple. You don't have to try to add anything to the finished finished work of the Christ. His name is Jesus. Amen. And that's what it says. The same way you received it. Well, I didn't know all that when I got saved, preacher. That's okay. You don't have to know much to get saved. Really, you don't. You got to know you're a sinner. You better know that. Oh, they won't preach that in the church no more. You're going to make people uncomfortable, man. They don't want to come back to church. I'm just telling you, we're all in the same boat, folks. We were all born of Adam. We were all born in sin. We all received a sinful nature from our father Adam. Come on. And listen, we all need the same remedy. There was a prescription written, and it was written by the Father, and it was the giving of His Son to die on the cross. Hallelujah. It says the same way you received Him. I didn't know that. Yeah, I know. I was a teenage flunky, showed up in that Berwick church and ran up to the altar and said, Jesus, I need you because I know I'm a sinner and I do. I believe this. I believe you died for me.
Yes.
The same way you received Him by faith and what He did for you is the same way you continue to walk in Him.
Amen.
Your daily life,
yes.
Hallelujah, as you traverse this fallen world. And let me tell you something. We're going to review it again. Temptation lurks around every corner. The draw and the pull of the spirit of Antichrist is trying to pull you away. I'm talking about the true gospel of Jesus Christ is going to set you free and light a fire in you, cause a light to shine out of you, and the enemy wants to snuff out your life. Because God is creating an eternal family. God is about His business. Listen to me. The Lord spoke this to me quite some time ago. My people are so consumed with what my work can do for them. Have they stopped long enough to realize that I'm asking them to work with me? I got a plan that I'm moving on this earth. I got something that I'm getting done here. I'm creating an eternal family. And I need some people that will allow the life of God to be on the inside of them. And let the light of God shine through them so that they might be able to be brought out of darkness into my marvelous life.
Amen.
I don't know about you, but I'm ready to let the Lord do a work. Hallelujah on the inside of me. He says, the same way you received Him, so shall you continue to walk in Him. Look at this, verse 7. Rooted and built up in Him, established in the faith as you have been taught. It's real important in the church that we teach. Abounding therein with thanksgiving. You know, I remember one time, I don't know if my mom would remember. Y'all know that area where they built those cabins over there by Lake Lord? Well, before they ever built those cabins, they kind of dredged some kind of way. They pumped sand all up in there. And then one day I was driving down there, and they had all kind of weed-looking things that were just growing out of nowhere. But it was like it was purposeful. They had done that. And I remember asking my mom, I said, I wonder what that's all about. She said, it's probably developing a root system, Matthew. I said, that's pretty good stuff right there, a root system. See, you got to have roots. Roots, what do? They prevent erosion. Roots help to that when a root gets in, it begins to develop an intricate root system, and it begins to hold the soil together. And what you need to understand is that the parable of the sower talks about the fact that whenever seed is sown amongst stony ground, it prevents the root from coming down. And whenever the sun, as though it be trial and tribulation from the word's sake, begins to shine, then guess what? The little life of the gospel that was planted in you begins to wither up because you had no root. So what the Apostle Paul's telling the church in Colossae is this: the same way you received Him, so shall you continue to walk in Him. You need to be rooted and established in the faith.
Amen.
You need to allow the Word of God, that seed that germinated and sprouted, to become rooted in you. Come on. Me and you need a root system, amen,
amen,
to prevent the erosion. The ways of the world, the spirit of Antichrist is trying to destroy us when trials and tribulation come your way, because they're coming. Can I tell you that?
Amen.
This side of glory, the trial and the tribulation, the frustration, the feelings of emptiness, the voids in your life, they're coming. Because this world is not going to bring you the pleasure that you seek.
Amen.
But nevertheless, faith in Him, rooted and established in Him, the joy of your salvation, the grace of God strengthening you, filling you, and moving you in the right direction. Hallelujah. That's the Word of God. It goes on to say in verse 8, but beware. It says, beware lest any man spoil you. The word spoil, I mean, this is an old outdated word. You ever heard of the pirate's booty? It's kind of like a treasure or the spoil. Really, the word here is to be taken captive. It's like there's a war that's being engaged in the spiritual realm. You got to understand that. There's a war being engaged. There's two kingdoms that coexist upon the earth, the kingdom of light, the kingdom of darkness. And there's a war that's being engaged. And Paul is warning the church of Colossae that you could be spoiled. You could be taken away captive. In the midst of all of this, the spoil would be when the victor wins. It's not just talking about rotten fruit. It's talking about you being taken away as the spoil. Does that make sense? Like whenever Rome would go and invade an area, they would take the spoil, all of the treasure, all of the valuable goods, and they would take it unto themselves. In this war for the souls of men, Paul is warning them, beware lest any man take you captive through philosophy and vain deceit. After the tradition of men, after the rudiments of the world, and not after Christ. We're going to get into it a little bit, but I need you to understand something, that there can be both the traditions of men and the traditions of God. I don't want to spend a whole lot of time on that here because I want to come back to that verse at the end, but it says right here, verse 9, for in him, in who? Jesus, in Christ, dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. Everything that God is showed up in the image of Jesus. Amen? Amen. And you are complete in him. You're not going to be found complete in anything that this world offers, but in Christ, you can find completion. Amen? Which is the head of all principality and power. Now, I got to tell you that there's multiple scriptures. As a matter of fact, we're about to read one that describe principalities and powers as fallen angels and demon spirits. And as a matter of fact, that concept about the rudiments of the world, many scholars believe that also is speaking about the forces of evil. But you need to understand that Jesus is over all of that. Yes. He's over the good angels. He's over the bad angels. There's nothing he that is in us is greater than he that is in the world. The enemy is going to try to come at you and attack you, but I'm here to tell you that if you're in covenant with God through the Christ, hallelujah, you have access to the power of God, which will give you victory in the midst of your struggle. Says right here in verse 11, in whom. You know, I heard one time that over 170 times the Apostle Paul uses that prepositional phrase. In him, in whom, in Christ. You got to understand it's your new position. Amen? You got to understand that this is the plan of God. That the first time you were born like your father Adam. Your first birth in Adam. The first Adam had gone the way of the liar, and now you and I, born of him, have been born with this sinful nature. As a matter of fact, let me just get one thing out of the way. One of the scriptures I was going to talk about this morning was Genesis 5:3. And it says that after 130 years, Adam had another son. His name was Seth. And he was born in the image and likeness of his father Adam. So whereas Adam was formed out of the unfallen clay of this pristine earth before there was ever a thorn or a thistle, God reached down, grabbed a handful of unfallen clay, molded it, and breathed his life-giving breath into Adam. And so Adam was created in the image and likeness of God. But then Adam fell. And after Adam fell, Adam's offspring were born in the image and likeness of their father Adam. And Adam, as the fountainhead of all humanity, meaning every single human being that has ever walked the face of the earth, has sprung forth from the loins of Adam's, except one. Jesus. Born of incorruptible seed. Amen. Born of the virgin. Yes. Hallelujah. The sinless one. You know, I say this a lot, but there's two men that have walked the face of the earth without sin, but only one died that way. The first Adam died in sin. He died at least with a sinful nature. But the last Adam, Jesus, came to make right.
Amen.
What the first Adam made wrong. And so, you and I, in our second birth, have been placed in Christ. It's important that you know that. It took faith. Faith in what? Faith in the finished work. Faith in Jesus Christ and Him crucified. Faith in the cross, not a wooden beam, but what happened spiritually. The significance of what took place in the spiritual realm when Jesus, dying His sinless life, paying the penalty, broke the power of the enemy and His ability to hold you and I sway under bondage. You got to understand something. The Word of God is the reason that you're free. The Word of God explains the reason that you're free, and that is because of what Jesus has done.
Yes.
We're about to talk a little bit about some traditions that have come into the church, at least the ones that bother me. And through faith in Christ, this is supposed to be Jesus right here. Through faith in Christ, a miracle took place in the mind of God. Now, what this is descriptive of is Romans chapter 6. Being baptized into Christ, you've been baptized into His death, His burial, and even as Jesus was raised from the dead, you too should walk in newness of life. And now you have a new position. A miracle took place. This is the plan of God. I'm telling you, this is the plan of God.
Yes.
You don't understand what I'm telling you. This is the plan of God.
Amen.
This is the gospel.
Amen.
I kept having preachers trying to tell me, oh, you're preaching Romans 6 again? You're preaching that cross again? Hold on a second. Time out, preacher. I'm preaching the gospel. What I'm trying to tell you is that the whole reason, again, that God called that man named Abraham out and created a nation was so that He could give us Jesus. Yes. And the whole reason He was giving us Jesus is not just so that some shepherd could view a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes, but that instead that baby was going to grow up one day and He was going to die on a cross to pay the penalty of the sins of humanity. This is the plan of God. And now God wants you to partake in that and to become one with Him in that so that He can change your nature, hallelujah, so that He can do a work on the inside of you. The gospel wants to change the inside of you. We're still talking about Colossians. We're still talking about the plan of God. We're talking about right here, verse 11, a circumcision that's made without hands. That's what I put all that in there. A surgical procedure done by the hand of the Spirit of God that reaches inside the heart of man and begins to cut away things that don't belong there.
Amen.
Amen.
It's an inside job.
Inside.
Can only be done by the New Testament truth that Jesus, what He did, allowed the Holy Spirit to tabernacle in your heart.
Amen.
The Holy Spirit found a new home.
That's right.
It's in the heart of Mr. Paul, it's in the heart of Matt, the preacher. It's in the heart of you who sit here and have raised your hand and said, yes, Jesus.
Yes, Jesus.
Come into my heart and live in me. Amen. He goes on to say in verse 11, hands in putting off the body of the sins of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ. Buried with Him in baptism. Now some people would say, we're going to talk about that. I'm going to talk about the traditions of men in a second about water baptism. You got to understand something. Water baptism is an outward ordinance. It's very important. That's why we baptize those people the way we did. The Lord told us to baptize people. It's an outward ordinance of what has taken place internally.
Amen.
Through faith in what Christ has already done.
Amen.
When you put your faith in there, this little depiction that I put on the board happened already in the mind of God.
Yes.
Whether you knew it or not, Matt walked around for 12 years as a Christian, didn't have a clue about this. Whenever he found out about it through the truth of the preaching of the gospel, thank God for Brother Swaggart and what he went through in order for God to be able to give him a revelation of it.
Amen.
And whenever that word came forth, and that was the first thing I heard, there's no water in the Greek text. I didn't know what he was saying, but I knew what he was saying. You're telling me that this isn't about the water baptism. You're telling me that something happened to Matt. The day he ran up to that altar with that long hair, dude, thinking he was David Lee Roth and bowed his knee to Jesus. And on that day, the Holy Ghost showed up and came to live on the inside of his heart. The problem Matt had, he didn't know it.
I didn't know it either.
Need a teacher to teach us.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
It happened then. In the mind of God, he saw me. He's a new creation right there. Can't wait till we get to that spot in Romans. We do want to teach you now Romans on Wednesday nights. If you ain't got nothing to do on Wednesday nights, 6:30, we'll be here. Can't wait till we get to that spot where we make the connection that God sees us this way, and he's just waiting for us to be able to see ourselves the way he sees us.
Amen.
Some power in that. But if you're never taught it, you'll never know what to put your faith in. And now, God, this doesn't have anything to do with my message. The Lord will take it. Now, as you walk in him, daily life.
Yes.
I like this way this one old preacher used to say, faithing. Mm. He wasn't just believing, he was faithing. It's an action word to put faith to it. I'm faithing in Christ. I'm walking each day, faith in Christ and what he's done. And it's given me access to grace, empowering. In the mind of God, that's what happened to you the day that you gave your life to Jesus. Buried with him. The old man dead. The old man born of Adam dies in Christ. Verse 12. Wherein also you are risen with him through the faith of the operation of God who has raised him from the dead. That's what it says, and I believe it's Romans chapter 8, verse 11. The same spirit that raised Christ from the dead will also quicken your mortal bodies. Hallelujah. The same spirit that raised Christ from the dead will also quicken your mortal bodies. Quicken, what does that mean? Give life. The same Holy Spirit that raised Jesus up wants to put the resurrection power on the inside of you.
Amen.
And give you life. Amen?
Amen.
And it says right here, verse 13, and you being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh has he quickened together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses. That's a good word right there.
Amen.
Jesus has already paid the penalty for every sin, past, present, and future. I'm telling you right now, anybody that tells you something different, that's not a license to sin. God help us if we turn the grace of our precious Lord Jesus into lasciviousness. God help us that if we cannot see the precious blood of Jesus, how it was poured out for us. Come on, I'm preaching to the preacher. Help us, Lord, to be able to see the severity of this situation. You bankrupted heaven of its most prized possession and allowed him to die, separated. That he said, Father, my God, why have you forsaken me? He didn't forsake Jesus because of Jesus.
That's right.
The separation that Jesus felt was because of Matt.
That's right.
Yes. Said right here, you being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh, he has quickened or brought life together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses. Look at this, verse 14. Blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us. Does anybody know what that means? What does that mean? Blotting out the handwriting of ordinances. What does that ordinance mean?
The law.
The law. That's exactly right. I like doing that now, asking y'all questions. I like it with y'all. It's like interactive sermon, amen? I'm cool with it. I don't know about you, but I'm good. Blotting out the handwriting of ordinances, the law, it was against you. It was contrary to you. Because why? Because you broke it. Each and every one of us in this room, and we'll still break it today. Because I told you, even if you keep the first eight. There's stuff going on inside of our hearts. Things that we see. The lust of the eye, the lust of the flesh, the pride of life. And we start coveting things. Can't hide that stuff. God's got x-ray vision. He can see.
That's
right, yeah. Says right here, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances, the law which was against us, which was contrary to us. It was speaking judgment and guilt towards us. It called us guilty. He took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. Hallelujah. See, Jesus, the righteous one, kept the law to its perfection. Then he laid his perfect life down on the cross and he nailed all of that stuff that was against you with him to the cross because he died in your place. Now the law can no longer call you guilty because you're not being judged by the law. You're being judged by the righteousness of Christ because God, in his mercy, in his grace, in his infinite wisdom, hallelujah, chose to make a plan for thousands of years where he called a man named Abraham out, create a nation out of him, and through that nation give us Jesus, the sinless one who would keep the law, die on the cross in your place, and by an act of mercy and grace and a love that you can't even fathom in your mind in a million years would allow a transference to take place as Jesus was suspended between heaven and earth. As just as Moses lifted the serpent, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, and then I will draw all men unto me. And through an act of mercy and grace, when you said, yes, Lord, I put my faith in what you provided. Hallelujah. He took your guilt, Jesus, and God gave you his righteousness. Now you've been clothed in the righteousness. once called you guilty can no longer call you guilty anymore because the law keeper.
Amen.
He sits right there at the right hand of the Father. His hands, nail scarred hands, show. And the price has been paid. Penalty has been paid.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus. It says in verse 15, and having spoiled principalities and powers, there's those fallen angels and demon spirits again. People say, oh, you preach too much about that. No, we don't preach enough about it. You're in a war, Christian.
Amen.
And they can talk to you about Rick Warren's purpose-driven life. And I lost my stuff here. Talk to you about Rick Warren's purpose-driven life and community outreach and all that other kind of stuff. But the fact of the matter is this. Is that you're in a war.
That's right.
He's over there. People are teaching a social gospel. And we're in the midst of a war.
Amen.
And God wants to give us victory. Amen?
Amen.
In the midst of this war. Thank you, Jesus. It says, and having spoiled principalities and powers. See, the vain traditions of men want to spoil you and take you captive, but I got good news for you. Jesus defeated the powers of darkness.
Amen.
It goes on to say right here, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it. The idea in the Greek is that the way Paul's explaining it is that the Roman Empire would go and take new lands. As they began to conquer the known world of the time, they would send their generals and their armies out. They would conquer these new lands. And what would happen is that they would bring these kings and their leaders with them back to Rome. They would leave certain people there to manage the affairs of the place. And they would bring the leaders back to Rome. And they would strip them of all their armor. And they would parade them in the midst of Rome as the citizenry stood and applauded their leaders for their victory and the fact that they conquered the enemy. That's the idea behind the Greek whenever it says he triumphed over them and made an open spectacle of them. So the idea is that Jesus in the spiritual realm, when he destroyed and defeated the works of the enemy, that basically they saw it. And they saw it in the spiritual realm. Hallelujah. When he ascended unto the Father, when he led captivity captive, those that were in Abraham's bosom. We don't have time to get in all that. But the spiritual realm saw that the plan of God continued to move forward. And the enemy of your soul wants to convince you today that it didn't work. But I got good news. Hallelujah. God's plans work. He says right here, let no man therefore judge you in meat or in drink or in respect of any holy day or the new moon or the Sabbath days. And that was part of the Gnostic heresy. Going back to verse 8 of Colossians 2, it says, beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit after the tradition of men, after the rudiments of the world, and not after Christ. And so there's the danger, if you will. We've been given this beautiful, glorious gospel. We've been given this beautiful plan of God as we dissect and break down what the Apostle Paul wrote to the church of Colossae. But right in the midst of it all, I didn't plan this, but I realize now I read 16 verses. And right there in the middle of it, verse 8, a warning. A warning that you could be taken captive through the philosophy, through vain philosophy. Vain means empty, hollow. And the deceit and the traditions of men. Yes. Now, I got to tell you that traditions in and of themselves are not always a bad thing. As a matter of fact, in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, the Apostle Paul gives us descriptions of two different types of traditions. In chapter 2, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 15. And then also in chapter 3, verse 6. But starting at verse 15, it says, therefore, brethren, stand fast and hold the traditions which you have been taught, whether by word, or our epistle. An epistle is another name for a letter. So you either heard us talking about these things, or in the letters that we wrote to you, hold fast to the traditions that we talked to you about. Now, there's another scripture that I put here out of Acts, and you don't have to turn there if you don't want. I can turn there for you real quick. Acts chapter 2, verse 42. These are some of the traditions that we learned from the apostles. Acts 2, 42. They continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, in the breaking of bread, and in prayers. The idea here is that there's a congregation of people of God fellowshipping with one another, learning the instruction of the doctrines of God, and also at the same time partaking together in communion, which is always reminding us of the finished work of Christ. And these are the traditions that Paul would talk about. Stay fast on the traditions which we have taught you, both in word and also in our letters. And then it goes on in chapter 3, verse 6. It says, "Now we command you, brethren, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you withdraw yourselves from every brother that walketh disorderly." It describes somebody that's pulled out of rank. If you can imagine a military procession and people are marching the way they're supposed to, and all of a sudden this brother just starts walking disorderly. He just peels off to the side and he just goes in whichever way that he decides to go. The idea behind it is that Paul is telling you that there's people that are going to start walking disorderly, and you're supposed to withdraw yourself from them and not after the tradition which he received of us. You can have traditions that come from God. You can have traditions that come from man. And we have to be wise enough by the grace of God to be able to discern the difference. It goes on to... This is what some of the stuff that I wanted to talk about real quick regarding the traditions that I think have come from men. I just picked three things. And, the first one is something that really hit home to me because it was a big part of my life and a big part of my failure as a Christian. It may not mean anything to you. You might have gotten saved in the last 3 years and you don't even know what in the world I'm talking about. But when I say the prayer line, I've been in churches before, and this is still rampant in much hyper-charismatic type churches, where the answer for everything that you seek is that you're going to come running to the altar and you're going to have hands laid on you. And listen, I'm all about laying on of hands. I'm all about anointing with oil. The Word of God speaks of that, about praying for the people. But what I'm trying to tell you is this, is that I can't tell you how, the reason that we think the wrong thing is because we're not being taught the right thing. You can say that it's not all the preacher's fault that Matt fought the wrong thing, and that is true. It's not all the preacher's fault because Matt wasn't doing his job to study the scriptures to show himself approved. And there is truth that there's probably many people in you here that went to the same church that I'm talking about, okay, and that you yourself maybe didn't think it exactly the way that I was. Maybe you had a better understanding of the word than I did. But my understanding of the word was at least as good as probably 50% of the people in there. And what I thought was this. The answer to my victory was I was going to go up to the prayer line.
Right.
Yes.
That's where the glory cloud was.
Right.
That's where the glory of God was, right up here. It was going to be right here, and the man of God's going to lay his hands on me, and sometimes he's going to push me kind of hard, and somebody's going to fall down, and then people are going to start falling. And see, now whenever you fall, you're going to get up, and it's going to be a whole new ball game. Well, the problem is I fell a couple times, and guess what? I kept getting up the same way. And the people that I know that were also falling, they kept getting up the same way. And so the issue that I have is that once again, I understand there's a scripture. You will not find one scripture in the New Testament that says anything about that. Yes, laying on of hands, yes. Anointing with oil, yes. Praying for one another, yes. You will find no scripture in the New Testament that talks about people coming to the front, falling out, wiggling around. That's a whole other thing. They got a whole other new thing going on. People crowing and barking, slithering. Listen to me. That's a problem, church. That's a manifestation of something going on. I don't know that it's of the Lord. When you start seeing people writhing around and jerking, listen to me. They got people doing this number here. Come on. Now, you got your pen and paper. I want you to write something down if you got your pen and paper. We just talking about the Bible. We're just talking about things going on. I'm just trying to warn you. Kriya. Google that.
Kriya.
Kriya. Kriyas of Buddhism. Eastern meditation. Whenever you empty your mind to allow control of a spirit of another kind, when you allow, you put Google Kriyas in the modern church. When you empty your mind through Eastern meditation and you allow a spirit of another kind to come in, and especially in Buddhism, you'll see in these videos as you do it, people go to doing this over here. They go to jerk. And the thing of it is this, is that we was calling that the anointing of the revival.
Yes.
People over there jerking.
Yes.
Kriyas. Come on, somebody. My point is that you won't find one place in the scripture. Oh, don't tell me in the book of Acts that's what they were doing. It says that they thought they were drunk because they spoke in other tongues and the people heard them speak in their own language. It doesn't say anything about people slithering around, barking and crowing and doing kriyas in the midst of the service. Lord, help us. Unite, that's not how you get free. Not because some man's going to lay hands on you as if he's got some mystical power on the inside of him. No, the way you're going to get free is by putting your faith in the one who died for you, set you free, baptized you, allowed the old man born of Adam to die, and a new man to be resurrected to newness of life. And now the Holy Ghost, as you keep faithing, walk in him the same way you received him, the Holy Spirit changing you. Yes. See, the enemy wants to come in through the traditions of men, empty, hollow, vain, and not going to get you anywhere and hold you in bondage. I've talked to people that said, dude, I've been in church since I was a little kid. I've been lied to. I've been lied to. I'm mad. I'm angry. The gospel was here the whole time. Why didn't they just preach the gospel to me? Why didn't they just speak the truth of God's word?
Right.
Well,
right.
Partly because they themselves were deceived.
That's right.
Slow your roll.
Right.
Pray for the brother.
That's right.
Because pray for me.
Yes.
Yeah.
The enemy wants to deceive.
That's right.
But that's how I was too.
Yep.
When I first started seeing, when the scales fell from my eyes, dude, I wanted to go over there and say, hey, look at this. What are you doing?
Yep.
I wanted to fix it.
Right.
And there's always a time and a place for everything. Mm-hmm. But I don't know that the way I was going to do it was right. I need Jesus to change me, man. I'm like ready to confront somebody. The enemy wants to steal from you. And then he does it through lying gospel, lying doctrines. And when you realize things have been stolen from you, you get angry.
That's right.
And you want to take a stand.
That's right.
The enemy wants to steal from you. That's right. The enemy wants to steal from you, and it will make you mad. And when you realize that the traditions of men and false doctrine have stolen precious time from you, it will make you mad. And so that prayer line thing, it made me mad. I realized. I was putting all my faith in that. I finally thought, I kept thinking that was what was going to set me free from putting that dip in my lip. I was so condemned about sticking that dip in my lip. And finally, one day, with a dip in my lip, I was worshiping the Lord after a revelation of the cross. And the Holy Spirit spoke to my heart and said, you know, I want to set you free from that. It had gone from a source of condemnation. The Lord had broke through all that, removed the guilt, removed the condemnation. I was able to worship the Lord. The Lord, with a sweet, small, still voice, said, I want to set you free from that. The work's already been done. And with one word from God, the bondage was broken.
Thank you.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. The bondage was broken. So listen to me. I don't know how long you've been waiting, and I don't know how frustrated you've gotten. Hold on to Jesus.
Right.
Don't quit.
Amen.
Because guess what? He's going to whisper it to you one day.
That's right.
I want to set you free. Amen. And when he whispers, stuff starts happening. Community outreach without the gospel. I know what Jesus said. When you fed the hungry, when you clothed the naked, when you visited me in jail. But guess what? In the modern church, we're embarking upon a pathway that does all of these things but isn't giving them the true gospel. That is not from the Lord. That is the traditions of men. Church of Christ baptism. For whatever reason, I wanted to put that in there. Because, see, people have heretical doctrines. And what the Church of Christ believe is that you can't truly be saved unless you've been baptized in water. And what they believe is that this is where the contact takes place between our sinful man and the blood of Jesus in the waters of baptism. That's not true. That's changing the gospel. The gospel, the way that our sinful man makes contact with the blood of Jesus is through faith. When we put our faith in there, a spiritual baptism takes place where the old man dies in Christ, hallelujah, and a new man is resurrected. And in the midst of it all, amen, we make contact with the blood of Jesus and our guilt and shame is removed. Hallelujah. Real quick to review, last 2 weeks, we talked about the garden. I know I've kind of gone on, but I think I'm going to be able to wrap this up pretty quick, okay? Last 2 weeks, we talked about the garden incident. First, we talked about temptation. I'm not going to go through all the points that I made, but the main point that stood out to me was that there was a tree in the midst of the garden. It says midst, and the word means center. It was right there in the middle. Everywhere you didn't matter if you came from the east or the west, it was right there in the middle. God strategically allowed that tree to be placed right there in the middle. No matter where you go on this life, no matter what corner you turn, I'm here to tell you that the enemy is lurking around the corner. Good news, because guess what? All you got to do is turn back to chapter 2 and you find out there was another tree in the midst That's of right. the garden, the tree of life. And so what you and I need to understand is that even though everywhere we turn and everywhere we go, there's going to be temptation waiting, at the same time, there's another tree that's waiting there. It's called the tree of life, and that tree is Jesus, I'm here to tell you. And if you eat from that tree, hallelujah, you will find life. Amen? Eat from the tree of life. The second thing that I noticed when we preached about sin was that they hid themselves from the presence of God. When they heard his voice, they hid themselves amongst the trees. And then also what happened at the end, verse 24, is that God expelled them from the garden and put the cherubim with the flaming swords, preventing their access back in. That's scary. That sin causes separation from the presence of God. Sin causes a change to take place in the creation of God where you don't want to hear his voice. Lord, help us to be mindful of that. Amen. That was just the review I wanted to talk about. That was the temptation and the sin. And now to talk a little bit about the way of Cain. In Genesis chapter 4, we just soon read the word of God. We'll just read the first 11 verses. It says in verse 1 of Genesis 4, "And Adam knew Eve his wife, and she conceived and bare Cain, and said, I have gotten a man from the Lord." Now, do you remember in Genesis 3, the promise that God gave, he told the serpent this. What did he say? He said, the seed of the woman is going to crush your head. Whenever Eve says this, the idea in the language is that she thought that this was the promised one, Cain. And that's what she was saying. I've gotten a man from the Lord. And she again bare his brother Abel, and Abel was a keeper of sheep, but Cain was a tiller of the ground. And in process of time, it came to pass that Cain brought of the fruit of the ground an offering unto the Lord, and Abel, he also brought of the firstlings of his flock, and of the fat thereof, and the Lord had respect unto Abel and to his offering. But unto Cain and to his offering he had not respect, and Cain was very wroth. It's another word to means to glow with anger. And his countenance fell. You ever seen somebody with a fallen countenance? Their face gets real long and droopy.
Disappointed.
And you're just really disappointed and unhappy. I'm sure I've had a fallen countenance a time or two in my life. And the Lord said unto Cain, "Why are you wroth, and why is your countenance fallen? If you doest well, shalt thou not be accepted? And if thou doest not well, sin lieth at the door, and unto thee shall be his desire." In other words, he wants you. "And thou shalt rule over him." And Cain talked with Abel, his brother, and it came to pass, when they were in the field, that Cain rose up against Abel, his brother, and slew him. And so we see in this passage of Scripture, we're moving from the previous chapter to the new chapter. And in the previous chapter, what we learned about temptation, we learned about sin. But we saw the first glimpse of the plan. Because what God told the serpent was that. But then in the end, remember what Adam and Eve tried to do to cover their sinfulness when their guilt and shame was exposed? They were walking around naked. What did they do? They sewed fig leaves, right? And they attempted in their own strength through the works of their own hands to cover their nakedness and their sinfulness. But in verse 21, the Lord said, no, that's not going to work. And he provided skins for them. Amen? Now, what you got to know about providing skins is that a sacrifice had to take place. The killing of an animal had to take place. And while we don't have a whole lot of theology at this point, later on we see the heart of God, because it says in Leviticus chapter 17, I have given you blood to make atonement for the soul on the altar. For the life of the creature is in the blood. So what is that saying? That's saying when you pour out the blood of the creature, he loses his life. It's talking about the sacrifice. The wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Whenever the blood is poured out, the life is given. And so what's happening here is that in order to provide skins, it had to come from an animal. And one of the things I got to tell you is that animal didn't sin against God. The animal had nothing to do with Adam and Eve's sin, yet he was the one that God killed and allowed his skins to cover Adam and Eve. And so we heard the proclamation of the gospel whenever he told the serpent, the seed of the woman is going to crush your head. That's where your authority is going to be broken, through the seed of the woman. It wasn't Cain. Ultimately, it was Jesus. And then also, until that time frame, you're going to continue to put your faith in this plan that I'm working, which is the shedding of innocent blood, to typify and to remind you as we look forward to the one that will come and he will shed his innocent blood. And then we turn the page to chapter 4 and we see there comes a time. A time where the two brothers bring an offering. Now what we have to believe is that Adam and Eve would have showed the two boys how it is to properly worship the Lord. And we see two different altars. It doesn't even say that there was an altar, but if you would permit me to speak that way. Two different altars being erected in this scenario. One altar, once again, has a blood sacrifice connected to it. The other altar, once again, has to do with the toil and the tilling and the sweat of the brow and the work of the hand and what man has now produced. See, the truth of the matter is that, listen to me, you know, you can look at God and you can say, well, Cain had a heart for God. Well, hold on, did he really? I don't know that he did. Because we got to understand that the serpent has already injected his venom in here. The serpent has already injected his venom in here, and it's already caused Adam and Eve to believe they can cover their own nakedness with the fig leaves. And now we see Cain, and yes, people want to worship something, but they want to worship God the way they want to worship God. I want to bring some vegetables. I'm doing some work. I'm over here sweating, and this is what I bring. And the Word of God says that God had respect for Abel's sacrifice, but he did not have respect for Cain's. I don't have time to turn there, and there's no way for me to prove it, but you would almost believe that there was something visual that took place to make the two boys realize God accepted Abel's offering, but he didn't accept Cain's offering. Now, we learn from Leviticus 9:24 that whenever they put the sacrifice on the altar, that the fire of God came down and consumed it. Meaning he allowed his judgment to be placed on that sacrifice, showing that he accepted the sacrifice. It also says in 1 Kings 18, whenever Elijah had a showdown with the prophets of Baal, God did everything silent over there as they're cutting themselves and doing all their crazy stuff. But whenever God shows up, he consumes the sacrifice that Elijah offered with fire from heaven. I can't prove to you that that's what happened, but it seems as though to me something visible took place. And whatever it was, Cain realized that God has no respect. He refuses to accept my sacrifice, and instead he accepts the sacrifice of my brother, and now I'm going to glow with anger. I'm going to get mad at God because I didn't get to have things done my way, and I wanted to serve God the way I wanted to serve God, and I wanted to go the way that I wanted to go. I'm here to tell you how I connect this to the traditions of men is this, is that fig leaves, Cain's altar, Abraham with Ishmael, come on, Abraham's trying to bring about his own plan. Jacob with a first sleeve, going to deceive his blind daddy Isaac. Moses going to kill an Egyptian and bury him in the sand. All of these people going their own way, trying to bring about the plan of God in their own lives, the traditions of men, the works of man's hands, trying to accomplish it in their own strength and in their own intelligence, trying to figure out things instead of going the way of God.
Amen.
But yet at the same time, God's got a plan too, the traditions of God.
Amen.
A sacrifice that covers with skins, a sacrifice of Abel, a promised child named Isaac, hallelujah. And you know, an altar, Levitical offerings that point to the day that Jesus would come, the traditions of God versus the traditions of men.
That's right.
And Cain becomes wroth, he glows with anger, he becomes angry with God. And so that was really my first point, was that Cain paved a different path. He paved a different path than the one that God would have paved. And we talked about the ways of God and how Noah, you know, let me not just skip Noah. I forgot to tell you about Noah. When we're talking about God's plan, you ever notice that in Genesis? I just think it's interesting. I'm about to close, I promise. I'll just hang with me just a few more minutes. You ever notice how many animals did Noah bring in the ark?
Two of every kind.
Seven
of the clean. They came in two by twos, but seven of the clean kind. Why is that? What's the first thing Noah did when he got off the boat? He built an altar, and he provided a sacrifice. God has a way. God has a tradition that he's been showing in the scriptures. Amen. And we do well to listen to the Apostle Paul as he wrote to the church of Colossae that we would hold, or to the church of Thessalonica, that we would hold to the traditions that they had shown unto us as they taught us the doctrines or the instruction from God that explains to us where to keep our faith and where to stay focused. Amen. And not to be caught up in the vain philosophies of men and to go to the altar of Cain where man is attempting to fix things his own self. And so I didn't want to leave Noah out, because you can see within there the plan of God. The way of Cain. There is no peace, but God still speaks. You know, in the midst of all of that, it said God comes back and he says, why are you wroth and why is your countenance fallen? When you go your own way, whether it be just a life of sin or whether it be you're under the wrong teaching of the gospel, there's a lack of peace in your life. Can anybody attest to that?
Yes.
There's a lack of peace in your life. And you're out of the way of God, but yet God in his mercy and his grace, he's still speaking the whole time.
Yes.
He's still trying to engage Cain in a conversation.
Yes.
He's saying, why are you wroth and why has your countenance fallen? It doesn't have to be that way. We don't have to walk around all the time upset. The joy of the Lord, hallelujah, can be our strength. That was one other thing I wanted you to see there. Now I want you to know that there is a right way. The Lord said to him, he says in the same verse, I believe it's verse 7, if you do well, shall you not be accepted? And if you do not well, sin lies at the door. I just want you to know that there's a right way. And the right way is the traditions of God. And it follows the pathway of all the patriarchs before. Yes, there were times that they ventured off. The same Abraham that offered up Isaac is the one that produced Ishmael. The same Noah that brought this clean animals is the same one that got drunk and let the mess happen. Okay, and so you see the repeatedness of this type of thing taking place. So I didn't plan on even saying that, but I got to tell you, the Lord wants somebody to know, yes, you may have deviated off the path. Yes, you may have made some mistakes. Good news. All of God's people haven't done everything that they were supposed to do, but hold on to the end. Hallelujah. And the Lord would say of you, well done, my good and faithful servant.
Thank you, Lord.
There's a right way.
There is.
And if you'll do the right thing, won't you be accepted?
Yes. That's right.
Go the right way. Go back and look at what your brother did, Cain. And you will be accepted. Sin wants to be your master. In that same verse, it says this. If you do well, shall you not be accepted? If you do not well, sin lies at the door, and unto thee shall be his desire.
Yes.
The word lie in some translations is crouch. It's like a crouch. Sin is being personified here. It means it's given animation, it's given life. And it's descriptive of a crouching animal, a predator, that's ready to spring forward and to attack. It lies in wait. It's quiet. It's dormant. You can see those little, not littles, but those big cats in a field in Africa, and they just move real slow.
Yep.
And they got all their weight and all their strength in their hindquarters, and they're just waiting to spring.
Yeah.
I got to tell you that sin wants to be your master. It lies at the door. It crouches and it waits. And it's deceptive, and it wants to spring forward, and it wants to overtake you.
Yes.
I got to tell you something. The enemy of your soul, he isn't playing games.
That's right.
No, he wants to destroy you. He wants to destroy you. Because we represent God. And he hates God. And he can't touch God. And so he's coming after the true believer with everything that he has. And listen, there's other believers in other churches that love God with all their heart, and it's not all their fault that they're under false doctrine. But as long as you are under false doctrine and you're being carried away by the vain deceits and the traditions of men, I'm telling you right now, you're not even in the game. You're sitting on the bench. And God's not even able to use you. But when you get into the truth and you allow the light of God to be birthed on the inside of you, two things. Number one, you got victory. Number two, the enemy, the sin, is persona. He wants to destroy you. But I want you to know that there is a way of victory. In the same verse, it says, it says, unto you will be his desire, but you shall rule over him. There's a way of victory, and it's the right way. Amen? Now, if we could just stay focused on what God has provided, I'm not telling you it's always the easiest thing, but if we could just stay focused and keep our faith in Christ and what he's done, amen, then we will be given the power that we need in order to live in victory over the works of the enemy. Lastly, this is what I wanted to close with, the way it came, what we can learn from the way it came. My brother-in-law Aaron preached a message for us before he went offshore the last time. He said, titled it, Light Rejected is Darkness Deep. And in Genesis chapter 4, verse 8, we see where God came to Cain, and he had a conversation. He was trying to reason with him. You know, in Isaiah, I believe it's chapter 2, it's like, come, let us reason together. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be mighty white as wool. God's constantly trying to reason with his people. Amen? And he wanted to reason with Cain. And the fact of the matter is that when it was all said and done, Cain rejected the counsel of the Lord. He rejected the voice of God. And his darkness deepened to the point that he destroyed his own brother. And the Bible has said on more than one occasion that the blood of righteous Abel cries out from the ground. Cain became the first murderer. That the book of Genesis is a book of firsts, and Cain became the first murderer.